People died below us, people died above us.
You can't protect people from themselves.
It was almost killed three different times.
In hindsight, clearly, we all made mistakes.
We were thinking we were going to die.
And it was ungodly hot.
There has been a substantial loss of life.
I look at that stuff on television, radio, and I said, oh, poo.
This is where it all began, 10 years ago. For more than 120 years, Mount St. Helens sat quietly in southwest Washington. Some geologists point out that many people didn't even know it was a volcano. But on May 18, 1980, after nearly 2 months of small eruptions, steam bursts and ashfall, and a good deal of speculation, Mount St. Helens loudly reminded the world that it was a volcano. The eruption killed nearly 60 people, forced hundreds from their homes, did billions of dollars worth of damage. We'll begin the story with those who were closest to the mountain when it blew.
The morning we were up there, we were planning to cut the rest of the unit that was left.
I had a good weekend. A lot of fun fishing and hiking and just doing all the things we usually do. It's paradise where we were. It's all virgin timber.
We chartered a plane and we took off from Yakima at 7:15 in the morning.
More than 100 people were in the shadow of the Mount St. Helens volcano on that Sunday morning in May 10 years ago. They had come to play and to work, to study and to watch. One of the watchers, an amateur radio operator named Jerry Martin, was one of the first to see the mountain erupt. His last words were captured on tape by ham radio operator Reed Apgar in Olympia, Washington.
Oh, I just felt an earthquake and didn't.
64-year-old Gerald Otis Martin volunteered to watch the volcano as part of a group called RACES, radio amateurs who were an official part of Washington State's emergency plan for monitoring the mountain. On that morning, Martin sat in his camper on a ridge 9 miles from the volcano, outside the restricted zone. At the same time, Weyerhaeuser employee Ed Hinkle, at his vacation home near Silver Lake, west of the mountain, experimented with a video camera that the company wanted him to learn how to run. Hinkle's unique videotape shows what happened that Sunday morning as Jerry Martin describes the scene with his last words.
Now we've got an eruption down here. Now we've got a big slide coming off. The slide is coming off of the west slope. Now we've got a whole great big eruption out of the crater. And we got another that opened up on the west side, a whole west side. Northwest side, it slides down.
The earthquake that occurred that triggered things was simply the straw that broke the camel's back.
Dr. Don Swanson came to Oregon just days after Mount St. Helens came back to life in March. Since then, he and other scientists had been watching an area on the north side of the volcano called Goat Rocks, which had been bulging outward.
We think that this earthquake was triggered by some movement within the bulge, and that was enough to kind of shake the whole thing, just like a bowl of jelly, as people flying overhead at the time commented on.
We saw a tremendous fracture open up. The fracture, it was as though the mountain were being divided in half.
And there was a tremendous steam explosion, a lateral blast, as all of the hot gases and water trapped in beneath the mountain slopes flashed the steam, and that propelled the avalanche material and the outer flanks of the mountain northward at 300 to 600 miles an hour.
5 miles north of the volcano, on a ridge, sat U.S. Geological Survey scientist Dr. David Johnston, who had set up his camp to give him a good view of the volcano. Johnston knew the mountain might explode.
How soon do you think that might occur?
Well, if it occurs, it would probably be no more than a few months on the outside, but it could be as soon as a few hours.
On Sunday morning, May 18th, Johnston was awake and watching. His last words by radio, "Vancouver, Vancouver, this is it." Searchers never found the body of David Johnston.
Jerry Martin sat on the next ridge back from the mountain, so Mother Nature gave him a few more moments to live than Johnston.
We got it, boy. The whole northwest section and north section blown up. Brian has come up over the ridge towards me. I'm going to back out of here.
Martin's last words seemed to indicate that he saw the blast cloud that killed David Johnston.
Gentlemen, the camper and the car set north to the south of me is covered.
The forest north of Mount St. Helens provided work for hundreds of loggers. On that Sunday morning, a crew of four men woke up, and three of them went to work at their job of thinning trees. All of them might have survived if they had listened to the fourth man, Jose Diaz, a Catholic who refused to work on Sunday.
As a matter of fact, he wanted to go back to town. You know, wanted us to drive back, and we said, no, we're not going to drive all the way back in there. No way.
James Shemanky says Diaz stayed at the top of the ridge where the group had set up camp and parked its truck. Shemanky, Aviante Sharapov, and Leonte Skorohodov hiked to the bottom of the ridge, the side away from the volcano, and set to work. Diaz saw the eruption first and knew it for what it was.
But then we heard Diaz and saw him way up above, running through the trees, screaming, "The volcano's exploding," in Spanish. He didn't even have his boots on. He was just like a madman.
The total energy release has been estimated as something like 10 megatons or even greater than that.
The eruption of the volcano heated the wind to several hundred degrees Celsius, as much as 1,100 degrees Fahrenheit.
In places, the blast is thought to have moved at supersonic speeds.
It sounded like freight trains or a jet or the ocean. It was just a huge roar just coming at us and was turning black. I started shooting stuff out. You could feel stuff coming through there. You could hear it coming through those trees. It must have been busting trees and cracking them, and then it just turned black, and it was just so much noise.
Today, Lou Moore and her two girls live in the shadow of the volcano. But 10 years ago, she and her husband had taken Bonnie, who was then four, and Tara, then 2.5 months, camping in the old-growth forest near Mount St. Helens. They were 6 miles outside the restricted zone.
We weren't worried about the mountain at all.
But the Moore family's camp was directly in the path of the supersonic blast from Mount St. Helens.
I looked up and I could see the clouds start to come over the top of the trees. When the cloud passed over, we were in the direct line of the lateral blast.
And we both looked at each other and just go, and the mountain blew.
32-year-old Bruce Nelson of Longview, Washington, didn't catch any steelhead that weekend. He and his friend Terry Krall and their girlfriends camped on the Green River Friday and Saturday night. They were just getting up Sunday morning when the volcano erupted.
It was like a nuclear blast then. It just, you know, it went dark, and we heard massive timber coming down around us, but you couldn't see it.
Nelson and his friends had camped in old-growth timber, some of it 100 to 200 years old. The 6 to 10-foot diameter trees may have slowed down the blast wave.
Here you are in God's country, and all of a sudden it's gone. Everything's gone, and it's a different color. It works. You wonder if you're even alive.
Nelson's friends died, crushed by one of the trees that fell around the foursome. Those same trees missed Nelson and girlfriend Sue Ruff. For Leslie Davis and her husband Dale from Mossy Rock, Washington, luck came in the form of a rare albino deer. The couple and their friend Al Brooks took a Sunday morning drive near Mount St. Helens to look for wildlife. Stopping to look at the nearly white deer delayed their trip. Had it not,
we'd been 15 minutes later, why, we'd been far up at Gilbert Lookout. There was nothing left there. A pickup with two people and it burnt.
As it was, the threesome was just below a ridge when they saw something up ahead and stopped to take a picture of it.
Just a cloud of eerie looking, just a mass of, well, I can't explain it, clouds. It was terrible looking.
And it followed the contour of the ground when it was coming. Just followed the contour of the ground. Come to a stump, it just went right on over down the other side, just like it was water.
They figure it took 30 seconds for the cloud to reach their truck.
The wing of our pickup, you know, the wing side of the door, blew out. And we had some old rags in there, and we stuffed that in there. And all we could do was sit there. It got hot. It was black. You couldn't see a thing.
The Davises say chunks of ice blown out of a frozen glacier on the volcano miles away pounded the outside of their truck.
I figured we'd been had right there. There's no way that we could have made it out of there. I just knew that it was impossible.
We were thinking we were going to die. We knew we were.
Standing here in the crater of Mount St. Helens, you're reminded of this mountain's power. All around, you can hear rocks falling off the walls of this caldera. But the power of the mountain in May of 1980 was such that it blew away a 2,000-foot rock wall that used to stand right behind me. 57 people beyond that wall died during that eruption. For those who survived the first moments of the eruption, the next few hours would be tough. But many of those who survived the first 10 minutes would make it out of the moonscape that Mount St. Helens created. But one man, perhaps the mountain's most loyal and oldest resident, didn't. We'll remember 84-year-old Harry Truman in a moment.
They have bloated out of all proportion.
Now, all this black stuff coming out of the mountain here, that's not being blown up by the press.
No, it's not being blown up by the press, but the magnitude is a thing.
On May 18th, 1980, the mountain stood more than 9,600 feet tall. By that time, it had been rumbling for nearly 2 months. More than 2,400 quakes of 2.4 or greater on the Richter scale had hit the mountain in that time. Nearly 400 quakes were a 4 on the Richter scale or greater. 84-year-old Harry Truman felt the quakes, but he also felt they wouldn't do him any harm.
You know, I've been used to them. There'd been 400 now in Therese. At least 400 has hit me. Day and night has kept me shaking around, quivering.
Truman ran the lodge on the shore of Spirit Lake, which lay directly north of the volcano. He'd watched as scientists talked about what the volcano could do to the area around it. But Truman refused to believe that the mountain was dangerous.
I look at that stuff on television, radio, and I said, oh, poo. The press has bloated up. They have bloated out of all proportion.
Now, all this black stuff coming out of the mountain here, that's not being blown up by the press.
No, it's not being blown up by the press, but the magnitude of the thing, the disaster thing, of the thing, I think that they're exaggerating.
KGW radio newsman Mike Beard says he talked to Harry Truman nearly every time he went to the mountain.
He never really expected that there was going to be any problem. He said it might erupt, but it's never going to reach old Harry. You know, it might spew out some rock and lava, but it's never gonna bother Harry Truman.
He made my life very difficult.
Dixie Lee Ray was governor of Washington when the mountain began acting up. She does not remember Harry Truman fondly.
He was always there poo-pooing everything that the state did, and the press loved him. The press did not love state government.
Governor Ray signed an executive order on April 3rd, 1980, restricting access to areas near the mountain. That was about 2 weeks after the earthquake started and a month and a half before the May eruption.
He made fun of and helped to encourage people to make it a game to see if they could get around the roadblocks.
The former governor also believes Truman may have been persuaded by the press.
They build him up as the hero who would stick it out. And he did.
He might have stayed there way beyond the time that everybody was suggesting, all the officials, everybody knew that he should clear out of there. He may have stayed put because of that.
He had lived there for more than 50 years. And on the evening of May 17th, 1980, Truman again refused to go. The next day, Spirit Lake Lodge and Harry Truman disappeared in the blast, which turned the lake from a vacation spot in the Pacific Northwest into a wasteland and the graveyard for 21 people who were never found. In a moment, we'll tell you how the world first learned of Mount St. Helens reawakening.
We were dumb. We had no idea how volatile the mountain could be.
We are directly over Mount St. Helens right now. We are at the 10,000-foot level, and there is no question at all that the volcanic activity has begun. You can see smoke and ash pouring from the top of the mountain, especially on the north side of the mountain.
Radio newsman Mike Beard broadcast the first reports that Mount St. Helens had begun erupting on March 27, 1980, nearly 2 months before the mountain claimed its first lives.
It was sheer luck. It wasn't dogged, good, hard work reporting. It was just because I was lucky.
On that day, Beard talked his boss into letting him fly in the station's traffic plane.
And eventually we got close enough to realize that there was a crater forming. And it was just forming, really, at the time that we arrived. We could see the snow caving in and collapsing on itself and falling in, and the crater getting larger.
The ash is going down along the slopes of the mountain, probably falling 1,000 feet or so, and the ash is very, very evident against the stark white snow along the sides.
We were we were dumb. We had no idea how volatile the mountain could be. We were having fun, really, getting down low and looking into the crater. It was warm. We could watch as we were going right over the crater that kept opening. We could watch the plane's altimeter go like that. We would be pushed up by the rising air.
It's very warm up there, by the way. It is almost barren of snow now, so it's obvious there's a lot of heat pouring out of the top of the mountain.
We sat here in geology offices reading books about volcanoes, studying the deposits of volcanoes, and then all of a sudden it was alive and dynamic. And vital.
Dr. Leonard Palmer teaches geology at Portland State University. 10 years after Mount St. Helens blew its top and wiped out 150 square miles of timber, Palmer sees volcanoes as a blessing rather than a curse.
The reason we have logs to log is largely a blessing, benefit directly from those ash falls, which many of us have cursed and been plagued by and wish they would go away.
Every day started with a consideration of what was with Mount St. Helens. Every day.
Washington Governor Dixie Lee Ray met personally with geologists just days after the first eruption.
The advice over a 2-month period remained consistent. The mountain might erupt. The mountain might gurgle a bit and then stop. And the mountain might blow its top.
Ray had tough choices to make. Should she restrict access to areas around the volcano?
Never in that time did anyone even suggest the possibility that if there were an explosive eruption, it would do anything but go up.
Was the possibility of a lateral blast discussed prior to May 18th?
It was. We hired a consultant to investigate some of the more esoteric possibilities, and that was an idea that he had that was under discussion when May 18th rolled around.
No one was looking at the mountain and seeing it. It was reaching the angle of repose, that landslides were beginning to fall off. It was breaking up and screeching constantly and just about to fail. No one looked at the obvious.
Geologist Dr. Leonard Palmer faults the U.S. Geological Survey scientists for not recognizing what was happening.
They're totally enamored with sophisticated instruments and measurements and not recognizing the simple, straightforward oversteepening of the flank of the mountain.
The most noticeable change was on the north side of the volcano, near an area known as Goat Rocks, where a bulge had developed.
We first detected the bulge probably in the middle of April or so, and we detected it just visually. It suddenly dawned on a lot of us and when we were together at the Timberline parking lot, that my gosh, that the shape of that volcano sure looks awfully strange.
As the mountain bulged and huge chunks of rock slid down its north side, something else was going on inside the volcano.
There is something heating up the groundwater underneath the volcano.
Geologist David Johnston could not know that in just over 1 month, that water, heated hundreds of degrees, would explode out of the mountain and across his camp north of Mount St. Helens, eliminating any trace of the 30-year-old scientist. The steam blasts, which began March 27th, continued.
They were prevalent throughout April, and then there was a period during early May when they kind of stopped for a bit, and they picked up again, and then for several days just before May 18th, there were no eruptions.
Oregonian newspaper photographer Michael Lloyd covered the volcano.
It was so awesome and so grand in its spectacle that it was almost pleasurable to go up and experience it. But then the dark side appeared on May 18th, and we got to see the horror that came with that beauty, too.
As May 18th approached, the earthquakes, thousands of them, tailed off. But the ones that happened were larger than ever.
So the same amount of energy, roughly speaking, was being released in a relatively few but larger earthquakes.
Friday, May 16th, Governor Ray decides to let Spirit Lake property owners into the closed area to grab a few belongings in a quick visit on Saturday.
Was allowing that much access perhaps even foolish in hindsight?
Probably. It was a very difficult decision.
They had been kept out for 2 weeks by the governor's exclusion order. The state police led the convoy with the promise of another visit on Sunday, a visit that fortunately never took place.
And had the had people been in at the lake and had the mountain blown straight up, There might have been time. It just depends on how fast the pyroclastic flow gets going. As it was, nobody would have had a chance.
The head of the Washington State Patrol, Robert Landon, sat on Spirit Lake Lodge owner Harry Truman's front porch at 6 o'clock on May 17th, less than 15 hours before the big eruption. He tried to talk Truman into leaving, but the old man stuck to the answer that he had always given reporters.
I've been here, and by God, this 54 winters will live her out, and I'm going to stay here until hell freezes over.
Geologists say an earthquake measuring 5.1 on the Richter scale shook the volcano that morning, triggering the weakened north flank.
And then this gigantic landslide took place, and all of the bulge began to move downslope at an ever-increasing rate.
We decided to make one final pass before we headed back to Yakima.
Dorothy Stoffel and her husband Keith, both geologists, were in a small plane directly over the volcano at 8:32 that morning.
When the north side gave way, what we were able to see looking straight down on it was the whole north side basically beginning to flow off and flow down towards Spirit Lake.
Geologists say a cubic kilometer of dirt, rocks, and trees slid off the north side of the mountain.
It slid into the end of Spirit Lake and displaced the lake water, and there was about a 300-foot wave of the water leaving the lake and into the adjacent peaks.
Right behind the landslide came a shock wave of air heated to hundreds of degrees and traveling for a time at supersonic speeds.
The best way I can describe it is like a blast, a bomb.
Bruce Nelson and his girlfriend stood in the way of the blast, sheltered somewhat by old-growth trees 6 feet or more in diameter.
I can't tell you what it looked like because all I saw was the ash cloud coming at us, and it hit so hard and it was so intense. A forest just total, just devastation. Just the only thing standing, if there was any trees standing, they were snapped off in the middle. And we're talking trees, some of these trees are 6 feet through.
Lou Moore and her family were 6 miles outside the red zone, sheltered by a ridge. The ashfall came in just minutes.
No light at all. You couldn't, if you turned on your flashlight, you had maybe about 5 inches of light. It just sucked it up because the dust was so thick in the air.
I thought I was dead. Actually, I thought lava was coming down and was covering us. This is what it felt like. We were being burnt so bad.
James Schimanke was outside the red zone, but within the range of Mount St. Helens.
You know, there was ash on there. All the trees were down. There was a few trees standing here and there. And I remember crawling over these big logs, you know, and they were smoldering. And we were in such pain by that time that thinking, Jesus, how long do we have to, you know, is it going to be before we die?
The blast from the volcano had burned Schimanke right through his clothes, welding his cotton work gloves to his hands.
It was so painful you couldn't stand up, so he tried to lie down. The ash was, you know, 8 inches to a foot deep.
1,000 feet above the exploding volcano, the pilot of the plane that carried Dorothy Stoffel and her husband didn't realize the danger. He decided to give his passengers a better view by dipping the wing of his aircraft.
And when he did that, we could see the blast coming up from below.
Dorothy Stoffel calls her life-threatening view of the eruption a once-in-mankind experience.
Really felt that, that we had bought the farm, so to speak. My husband, on the other hand, was just really excited, and he started yelling, oh, neat, oh, neat, oh, neat.
Ed Hinkle's videotape from that day shows the lightning flashes created by the cloud of ash particles above the mountain.
It was a constant shooting of material with lightning arcs and flashing. It was absolutely overwhelming. Total overload of the perception.
Geology professor Dr. Len Palmer rushed to the mountain that Sunday morning to watch an event he'd never seen.
And the particles that I could try and time moving up were moving way over 100 miles an hour, probably large white blocks of glacier being carried up with the rest of the material, some 60,000 feet up into the air.
When news of the big eruption reached the state capitol, then Washington Governor Dixie Lee Ray was here at her home on Fox Island near Tacoma.
I got the word by telephone as I was right outside the house here on my way to a meeting in Seattle.
Ray had the advantage not only of being governor, but of being a scientist. She is a former National Science Foundation staffer, former director of the Atomic Energy Commission, and director of the Pacific Science Center in Seattle in the early 1970s. Ray immediately ordered up her state airplane and had the pilot fly as close as he dared. Close enough not only to see it,
but you could hear the roar, even within the airplane. You could see these enormous clouds of churning material and lightning flashes and rain coming down and so on.
The eruption tore more than 2,000 feet from the top of the nearly 10,000-foot peak. It blew half a cubic mile, or about 3.3 billion cubic yards of dirt, into the air. The plume of ash pushed more than 13 miles into the sky above the volcano. In the North Toodle Valley, the landslide from Mount St. Helens flank buried the area to an average depth of 150 feet. Some parts of the valley now lie under 600 feet of dirt and rocks. The blast wave tore through 230 square miles in a nearly 180 degree path north of the mountain. It blew down as much as 4 billion board feet of trees. The Forest Service says that's enough to build 300,000 two-bedroom homes. Hundreds of people were evacuated from their homes as floodwaters from melting snow on the volcano inundated the valley below. The Forest Service says 27 bridges were destroyed or damaged. 185 miles of road were ripped up. 200 homes destroyed. 31 ships stranded in the Columbia River as ash clogged the main channel.
I don't know that there's in recorded history in our nation that has ever been a more formidable explosion.
President Jimmy Carter flew over the blast zone in the Marine One helicopter only days after the eruption.
Enormous cave-ins are taking place. Steam is bubbling up. There are a few fires about. Someone said it was like a moonscape, but it's much worse than anything I've ever seen, pictures of the moon's surface.
Based on what local officials told him, President Carter put the blame for the deaths on the victims themselves.
Interested people, curious people, refused to comply with the directives issued by the governor, the local sheriff, the state patrol, and others, and slipped around highway barricades and entered the dangerous area.
But in fact, only three people were inside the restricted red zone, and they had permission to be there. The rest of the dead were outside the zone.
The total amount of damage done by that mountain on that day in May of 1980 ran to more than $1 billion. One estimate by the state of Washington put it at $2.5 billion. But emergency officials didn't have time to count their losses. They were too busy trying to rescue those people who had managed to survive the eruption. We'll introduce you to the rescuers in just a moment.
You start thinking, well, is there some giant mortar machine sitting over here waiting to throw some more of those at us?
The H-1 Huey helicopter was the basic workhorse of many rescues during the hours and days that followed Mount St. Helens' May 18th eruption. Colonel Dave Mullen and Colonel Otto Hyde figure they were in the air within an hour of the big eruption.
We've got several sectors laid out, and we're assigning two aircraft to each sector to search the sector. As far as looking for people, we go up and we'll look for footprints and truck tracks. They're very easy to spot in the ash.
The Air Force rescue crews are prepared to fly in wartime conditions, but they admit that they didn't really know what they were flying into. The first indications of the enormity of the disaster came when the helicopter was still miles away from the volcano.
Yeah, it was right in here, as I recall, probably down there on the road, may not even be there by now, but it was right in here that we saw the first car that I described earlier that had the first casualties on board. So, you know, we knew that it was lethal out to this range for some reason, which we didn't fully understand at the time.
The helicopter crews realized that they were headed towards something they had never dealt with before, and they worried it might still be deadly.
We still didn't know whether what we were observing was just a prelude or whether the major event had already occurred.
But Colonel Hyde knew that the destruction was still going on, and he watched it happen.
I've watched the original bridge just disappear. At this point, the river looked like, it reminded me of when you see a cement truck and the cement comes down the slide. That's what it looked like in here.
As he neared the volcano, Hyde saw Camp Baker, a logging camp set up by the Weyerhaeuser Company, where floods had hit the heavy equipment stored there.
It was as if they were all Tonka toys and somebody just taken their hand and shoved them up in the corner of the room. They were all on their side and upside down. 40, 50-ton vehicles.
The two pilots began to see huge white chunks of material on the ground when they were still miles from the volcano.
In other words, the mountain hurled pieces of ice as big, probably half as big as the First National Bank building, 2 or 3 miles down the river here.
You start thinking, well, is there some giant
giant mortar machine sitting over here waiting to throw some more of those at us.
Despite the conditions and the dangers inherent in making rescues near a live volcano, the crews forged ahead.
A quarter of a mile into that blast zone, we spotted a car with, it looked like, two people. One person sitting in it, and one person, I think, was partially leaning out a door.
Garvin Williams is now the non-commissioned officer in charge of pararescue, or PJ, operations for the 939th Aerospace Rescue and Recovery Group in Portland. He was on the first helicopter in that day. Williams and another PJ were dropped into the damp soil where the Toodle River had run 90 minutes before. Above them, the landslide from the eruption had dammed the river.
We got about halfway and the helicopter came up on radio and said, we heard one helicopter tell the others, you better get those PJs out of there. We're observing a wall of mud and water that's taking this valley out.
Williams and his partner pressed on to the car and found the occupants inside dead. They were 14 miles away from the volcano. The two ran to a nearby road where they found a radio reporter driving into the area.
And we were very happy to see somebody with a car, you know, that wasn't dead.
They forcefully persuaded the reporter to drive them to a point where the helicopter could pick them up again. Williams says they beat the flood by 2 or 3 minutes. After they dropped the reporter off in a safe area, they flew back up the valley past the same spot.
We seen the car that we'd come down the valley in tossed right up into the trees by this flood. I mean, it took that car and left it on top of some little tree.
Pararescue man, or PJ, Rick Harder, had problems too when his pilot, Otto Hyde, tried to land in the volcano's fine ash.
It'd be complete whiteout, and the best way to describe it is taking a big fan and dumping, like 100 pounds of flour in front of it, and then try to walk around a room.
The answer was to lower the PJs on a hoist using a 250-foot cable. But the wind from the helicopter would start stirring up dust even 250 feet above the ground, destroying the pilot's visibility.
In other words, you'd be trying to hover inside of a ping pong ball.
Pilot Otto Hyde says the answer was to hover at 500 to 600 feet, lower the PJ on 250 feet of cable, then swoop in and drop him off before the dust rose. Picking up the PJ and the survivor was even more difficult.
If you can imagine sitting on a chair that's attached to a quarter-inch cable that's 250 feet long in a sandstorm and then being jerked off the ground and through a bunch of fir trees, that's what our PJ and the survivor had to go through.
Harder still keeps part of the rescue hoist in his locker, a steel ring that was bent when he and a survivor were pulled through trees on the way out.
Everything is absolutely ash gray, including the people.
Just finding survivors was a problem. In May 1980, a search official provided an example of how hard it was to spot people on the ground.
They saw a little black spot among all of this ash. Going down closer, it was a man totally covered with ash, but he had done some moving and walking, and he'd worked up a sweat which had got the ash on his face, where on his brow where he was sweating, dark, and that is the only thing they could see in this man. They could not see his movement.
But when they did find survivors, the PJs found they could do things they had never done before.
You can stuff 23 people in a Huey helicopter when you have to.
We'll get people and throwing them on and get them back down to Castle Rock, throwing them off and getting back out. And just as many we were taking people, their dogs, anything and everything.
When we began this program, we introduced you to a dozen people who had been trapped by the eruption of Mount St. Helens in May of 1980. Some of them managed to make it out of the blast area on their own. You can see the kind of conditions that they had to contend with. Others needed the help of the helicopter rescue crews. But all of them describe it as an ordeal that has affected their lives. We'll tell you how they escaped in just a moment.
He said, I can't make it. Just leave me here and you two go on. And I said, no way. All three of us come in and we're all going out.
I had too much to take care of. If we were going to survive, it had to be done. If you were going to panic, you weren't maybe going to survive.
Mount St. Helens eruption trapped Castle Rock, Washington resident Lou Moore, her husband Mike, and two daughters in the forest north of the volcano.
First of all, everything is covered all in brown, so it doesn't look right.
The family had parked its car just 2 miles away with extra food and water on board. Half a mile down the trail, the Moore family ran into timber blown down by the volcano's killing blast.
We're talking about virgin old growth. This is not small tree. These are large trees laid down like matchsticks.
4-year-old Bonnie was along on the trip. Now a teenager, she recalls part of the journey out.
I remember how it was so dark and all the ash was all over.
At the time, her mother says Bonnie behaved like a trooper.
She knew, I think she sensed from us that this was important. When we asked her to go somewhere or to climb up over something, she simply did it.
At one point, though, the little girl finally wore out. The Moores knew she liked to have her picture taken, so they did, and the smile came back. Nearly 6 hours of climbing over blown down trees brought the family only a mile and a half, so they camped for the night.
If hell is any hotter, I don't know what could be.
Leslie Davis, her husband Dale, and their friend Al Brooks drove into an inferno that morning. Ice and debris hit their pickup so hard it blew out a window. The ash fell so hard they couldn't drive, so they walked.
Mr. Brooks that was with us kept saying, "Leave me." He said, "I can't make it. Just leave me here and you two go on." And I said, "No way." All three of us come in and we're all going out.
And it was ungodly hot.
The group had a thermos of coffee that they used to wet their mouths, but no more.
We went down to get some water out of the Green River and you'd take a handkerchief. And it was so hot you couldn't wring the handkerchief out. That's getting warm.
We were burnt so bad, you know, all you can think of is water.
Logger James Shemanky and his three co-workers were in much worse shape than the Davis family.
The only thing I was thinking of then is how long is it going to take to die out here? I mean, because there was no way out.
Burns covered their bodies, but they began walking and made it 4 or 5 miles by Shemanky's reckoning when nature stopped them.
I mean, it was like a mountain, like somebody just pushed a mountain out in front of the road and that was it.
The group found a spring and drank all they could. Doctors would later say that that may have saved Shemanky's life. But at the moment, he and the others were trapped.
You can't go up, you can't go down, you can't go around. There's nowhere to go. And you're out there and you're burning up and you're, you know, being dead is a hell of a lot nicer than, you know, trying to suffer through that crap, especially after 6 or 7 hours of it.
And then you start thinking, well, shoot, is even Longview still there? I mean, obviously it's devastated for how far is it devastated? Well, it could be devastating to Portland.
Bruce Nelson and his girlfriend Sue Ruff found themselves under the timber blowdown, their lives saved when falling trees formed a pocket around them. Their two friends, only 12 feet away, were crushed to death by a tree.
You don't know if the mountain's going to blow again. Any minute, it could blow again. The heat can come through again, the blast. So the fear was enormous all day, the whole hike out.
Nelson figures they hiked for 18 hours, encountering bizarre sights along the way.
Hiking out was kind of an experience because we came across herds of elk that were just standing there in daze, and one side of them would be completely burned away, and the other side would just be perfect, just like they were, just nothing happened to it.
These are the shoes that I walked out in. They don't look much like it now, do they? You can sure still see the ash in them.
Leslie Davis and her husband Dale walked 26 miles to get out of the blast zone around Mount St. Helens. They walked out to find that their son-in-law, who was only a few miles downriver from them at the time of the eruption, died in the flood.
On the way out, I knew it. I stopped the guys and I told Dale, I says, you know, I says, Keith is gone. He's missing. And they just had a premonition.
After a while, we could see planes way, 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 way off, or hear them way off in the distance. I mean, I don't know how many miles, but nowhere near where we were.
James Shemanky says he and his badly burned co-workers were, in his words, losing it. They became irrational. Evante Sharapov hiked away toward a valley, ignoring the protests of the others.
We saw the mud flow come through there where Sharapov had disappeared. You know, just a big, massive, we didn't know what it was. It had boulders in it, trees, everything.
Sharapov's body was found 52 days later in a tree where he apparently tried to take refuge. Jose Diaz climbed over the avalanche and was picked up by helicopters, but he died a few days later at a Portland hospital. Shemanky and Leonte Skorohodov waited, expecting to die, but the helicopters finally came.
They had followed our tracks down from the truck.
The odds of walking off the mountain were very slim.
Bruce Nelson, the baker from Kelso, and his girlfriend walked far enough out of the blast zone that day that the helicopters could find their tracks in the gray ash.
And so we took off the sweatshirts we'd been breathing through and started beating that ash, and it made a big ash cloud, and the National Guard spotted that.
The helicopters spotted the Moore family on Monday, May 19th, and dropped in P.J. Rick Harder.
You know, I seen three people, And then in the pack, I'm hearing this crying, and it was like four people.
Harder and Eck were trying to figure out how to get the Moore family out when the word came that another eruption might be underway.
We're hiking around, and the mountain's blowing, and the C-130's telling all the helicopters to leave, and you're trapped with these husband and wife and their two kids and nowhere to run other than uphill.
Harder called for a small helicopter to come lift the family from a sandbar. The pilot tried to tell Mrs. Moore to drop her pack, the one with her 2.5-month-old daughter in it.
He wanted to take my pack and throw it in the river. We're underneath the helicopter rotor, so I can't tell him what's in my pack. I have one end of it. He has the other. We're struggling. He finally decided that I think what he decided was I had flipped out and I could have my pack if I was going to insist on it.
The little girl, Tara Dawn, who now goes by Tara, has no memory of the events of that day.
They had filed a suit on May 17th. For preventing them from going in. And then on May 19th, they filed a suit for not having protected them better.
Mount St. Helens eruption blew out 1/3 of a cubic mile of volcanic ash in addition to about 1/3 of a cubic mile of dirt and rock. Scientists at the Mount St. Helens National Monument did some calculations regarding that ash. It's enough material to cover one football field to a depth of 150 miles. They figure that the 540 million tons of ash spread out across the country, covering 22,000 square miles. The ash crossed America in 3 days. It circled the Earth in 15. Mount St. Helens ash blew east from the volcano, blanketing small towns in Washington state. This is what it looked like just past noon on May 18th in Yakima.
Visibility in the local area is down to 100, 125 feet in places.
The dust caused problems for travelers, stranding hundreds of people and causing mishaps. Mount St. Helens had 5 more major eruptions in the summer of 1980. Each included explosive activity, but caused no more deaths. On June 12th and 13th, freak winds blew south and dropped ash on Portland. The city figures that the cleanup cost more than $1 million. The flood and ash damage to Washington state was heavy, and the Federal Emergency Management Agency, known as FEMA, moved in.
FEMA's a fraud.
Ray says that FEMA's rules led to bizarre results in some cases.
If in cleaning up the ash they had used brooms, the cost of the broom would be reimbursed. But if they used a shovel, the cost of that would not be reimbursed because you can use a shovel for something else. It wouldn't wear out. You look astonished. I swear that is the truth.
The lawsuits that followed the eruption also anger Ray, like the one filed by homeowners near Spirit Lake.
They had filed a suit on May 17th for preventing them from going in. And then on May 19th, they filed a suit for not having protected them better, you know, for their losses. That suit, I think, was just thrown out.
The eruption cooked Spirit Lake, changing it from a beautiful, deep blue alpine wonder surrounded by trees to a dead body of water surrounded by waste.
Well, right now, there isn't a lot living in Spirit Lake.
Mount St. Helens Monument scientist Peter Frenzen says the eruption heated the lake to body temperature that day, sloshed all of the water out, and dropped tons of burned organic material into the lake's waters.
They looked like coffee or tea in color, and they were warm, they were nutrient-rich, and they were a microbial paradise. And the bacterial populations exploded and used up all the available oxygen. So even if fish had survived, they wouldn't have been able to live because the lakes went completely anoxic or without oxygen.
Frenzen says scientists were not optimistic about the recovery of the forest.
The expectation that a lot of people had after the eruption, and that was shared by the scientists also, was that the area was lifeless. And that was a function of the fact that, you know, there had been so much apparent destruction, and then this uniform gray ash had been laying down on top of everything. So your first impression as you went in was, wow, you know, moonscape, everything's gone, everything's lifeless.
But life has come back in the area around Mount St. Helens. 110,000 acres have been set aside as a national volcanic monument where the recovery process will not be helped by man. Yet plants have come back. Plants came back up through the ash. Some gophers and ants that lived underground survived. Elk and black-tailed deer have thrived in the monument where hunting is restricted. Birds only survived on the fringes of the blast zone, but they moved back into the devastated area within hours, days, and weeks, according to monument scientists. In fact, geologists who first visited the crater were set upon by hummingbirds who noticed their bright flight suits. And people have come back to the area around Mount St. Helens.
Here, that's the pre-eruption surface there. So you can see right here how much deposition and fallout there was on the south side.
Oh!
Jesus, that's quite impressive.
Right there.
Whoa. Incredible.
Give me five.
Okay. All right, everybody look like you're having a good time.
You can see by the people up here today that we get all kinds, and that's really one of the beauties of this mountain, is that it's available to people of all sorts of abilities and backgrounds, people who wouldn't normally climb mountains, who don't consider themselves climbers, would climb this mountain.
15,000 people are given permits to climb to the volcano's rim each year.
Mount St. Helens blew out more than half a cubic mile of dirt and rock on that day in May of 1980. For many people, it cost money. But for some people, Mount St. Helens ash has been a money maker.
Came up with the idea, and right after the mountain blew, she worked on this stuff in her kitchen. And then she told me we're going to go into business and make this stuff and sell it, and I laughed at her. We started selling it, and we doubled our gross in about 6 months. And for the first 4 years we were in business, we doubled our gross each year. To work for yourself is a lot of fun. And so that's what happened. That's what we did.
Mount St. Helens World. I have owned it for 6 years. We started out very small on a very limited budget, and it just a year after year we have expanded and rolled it back into merchandise, and have we have a very, very good local following that brings in a lot of their friends and relatives that visit from out of town. Basically, we have about 50% of our items have to do with Mount St. Helens or Mount St. Helens related with ash products. Some of them started out to be sort of a circus atmosphere. They have developed into some nice quality gift shops with good lines of merchandise that are, permanent locations. And we get to deal with the tourists on a day-to-day basis, and that for us is a real pleasure.
When the volcano is going to erupt next, what kind of an eruption that's going to be, we really don't know much more than we knew before.
All of the scientists we talked to say that research on the mountain, which was well-funded immediately after 1980, is now thin. Geologists say that research on the mountain may help predict the eruption of other cascade volcanoes.
So I think that Mount Hood is a very good possibility.
Mount Hood has been doing some rattling and shaking and fairly consistently through the months. Been doing a lot of rattling and has steam.
Geologist Dr. Len Palmer worries about cascade volcanoes and the communities that have grown up around them.
The fact that we had a mountain like Mount St. Helens right next door to Mount Hood has not been translated into the designs and the building codes on Mount Hood. We see, as we know, the Forest Service planning high-rise facilities exactly in the blast zone.
Mount St. Helens left its mark on the land, but it also left its marks on people.
It just seemed to take the life out of us.
Leslie Davis and her husband walked out of the ash and destruction to learn that their son-in-law had been killed by the eruption.
The only thing we ever found of him was his fish basket and his flagpole. I went back in there several times, combed the area, and we even took dogs in. Nothing.
I don't trust that mountain. I would never go back over there.
The odds of walking off the mountain were very slim.
Bruce Nelson went back into the blast zone 5 days after his escape to look for his friends, Terry Crawl and Karen Varner.
And I found the bodies of my friends, and they were dead.
Nelson still skis cross-country near Mount St. Helens in the winter and rides motorcycles there in the summertime. The Kelso Baker looks at it philosophically.
My opinion is I should have died 10 years ago.
Logger James Shemanky remembers his arrival at the hospital after his rescue.
Two doctors conversing, saying, oh, God, there's nothing we can do for him here. We're not equipped for this kind of thing.
Mount St. Helens' hot breath burned 53% of Shemanky's body, leaving him unable to do the kind of work he'd done all his life. Yet the state decided he was only 10% disabled. Today, he lives in Woodburn, Oregon.
I value color. That was such a vivid memory for me, the third day back. First day, all brown.
For 2 years after the eruption that nearly killed Lou Moore, her husband, and children, she worked to make the area a national volcanic monument, which it is today.
It was August before I was willing to go back up there. And it was just not something that I really wanted to do. I had to work at it.
People ask whether Mount St. Helens and the area around it will ever be the same. Scientists remind us that Mount St. Helens has erupted before, and the area has recovered. It's begun that process now, and the scientists say that while it won't happen in our lifetimes, the children and grandchildren of the people who experienced this eruption will see the forest grow around Mount St. Helens again. At Mount St. Helens, with photographer Andy Elliott, Lars Larson, the 10 o'clock news.
I look at that stuff on television, radio, and I said, oh, poo.
Really felt that, that we had bought the farm, so to speak. My husband, on the other hand, started yelling, oh, neat, oh, neat, oh, neat.
And it was ungodly hot.
And we were burned so bad that, all you can think of is water.
Thank you.